Good evening, everyone. In our last class, we were discussing about this atomic optical spectrometry. And over there, we have discussed that atomic optical spectrometry, it can be of three types. The first one is the atomic absorption spectrometry. Second one is the atomic fluorescence spectrometry. And the third one is atomic emission spectrometry. Okay. So, in all of these, three spectrometric technique, we have seen that atomizer, which we discussed in our last class, that this atomizer, it plays an important role as it converts the samples, whatever you are using, to atoms. Okay, so atomizer converts samples to atoms. Okay. And it plays an important role in atomic optical spectrometry. Okay. We discussed about this atomic absorption spectrometry, this single beam spectrometer and double beam spectrometer, how it happens. And over here, you see there is a source. Then we have the atomizer. Then we have this wavelength selector and detector and the electronics breakout boards. Okay, in the second thing, we have seen this one, there is a double beam spectrophotometer. Apart from the single line, there is another reference beam, and this beam splitter, it is being controlled by an electronics system, and it controls the beam splitter so that at one instance it passes the radiation through here, and the other instance it pushes the radiation from the source directly to these concave mirrors. And again, both these things are both these beams are recombined using the beam recombiner. And since they are separated with time, this electronic board or electronics system, it has the information of that. And it has both the information about both the reference beam and the sample beam. Okay. Then we have discussed about these hollow cathode lamps. Okay. So we have discussed that they are also regarded as a cold cathode lamp, and they are also regarded as line source atomic absorption spectro. And these are used for line source as line source for atomic absorption spectroscopy. Okay. Line source means, we have also discussed that line source means it will generate wavelength or specific what you call, it will generate a radiation or specific wavelength. Okay, now depending upon the ions or atoms which needs to be analyzed, our cathode over here will be changed. Apart from this, we have again electrodeless discharge lamp, which is again a line source, and a deuterium hollow cathode lamp, which is again a line source. Okay. Then we have also discussed that there are continuum sources, which is used in continuous source atomic absorption spectroscopy. And we have discussed under this xenon arc lamp, which are generally used, they are used, and it can generate radiations in the wavelength of 190 to 900 nanometers. Then we have discussed about the functioning of the hollow cathode lamp, how it works. Okay, and we have discussed all these things, right? Now, after the source, we have atomizers. Okay, we have atomizers, and among the atomizers are basically categorized into different types, or atomizers are of different types basically. Okay, the first one is the flame atomizer. Okay, and then next one is the electrothermal atomizer. Then we have glow discharge atomizers, hydride atomizers, and cold vapor atomizers. Okay, however, in practical use, the flame atomizers and the electrothermal atomizers, they are used for developing the atomic absorption spectroscopes or any other optical spectrometers. Okay, so we will be basically discussing about this flame atomizer and electrothermal atomizer. Okay, now in flame atomizers we have two types of systems. In one, the flame is generated using a mixture of air acetylene flame, okay, where the temperature is 2300 degrees centigrade. And in the next, in another one, we have nitrous oxide and acetylene which are there, and this mixture, nitrous oxide and acetylene, they generate flame which is having temperature at around say 2700 degrees centigrade. So depending upon your use, so this is called the low temperature LT, and this generates high temperature HT. Okay, so depending upon what temperature range you may need, you may either use air acetylene mixture for generating the flames, or you may use nitrous oxide acetylene mixture for generating the high temperatures. Okay, so nitrous oxide system, they offer higher reducing environment and is suited for analytes with high affinity to oxygens. Okay, so why this is so? Because nitrous oxide system is more, it undergoes more oxygen, results in the rapid oxidation of this acetylene. Okay, so heat what is being generated, it results in the rapid oxidation of this one, and thereby it is providing you the reducing environment. Okay, so in the electrothermal atomizers, they are discrete atomizers. Okay, whereas in the flame atomizers, they were continuous atomizers. It just like your cooking gas. So once you put on this the flames on your cooking this thing, we call that a chulha. I forgot the English name, it's not coming to my mind. So when you stove, okay, so when we put on the stove, right, so until and unless we you switch it off, it the stove will be burning. Okay, so if you provide the sample continuously, it will be getting oxidized over here, and it will do the atomization process continuously. Okay, whereas in the electrothermal atomizers, it is a discrete atomizer. That means you put in your sample into the atomizer, you finish the analysis of that sample, and then you go for the next batch of analysis. Yeah, so basically what these atomizers do. So if your sample, it is in the solution form, first it what it does, nebulization. What is nebulization? What is nebulization? It converts this thing into
aerosol.
Okay, small droplet like thing. Okay, the nebulization process, it converts the liquid solvent into the sprays. Okay, into the smaller droplets. And once you have these droplets, these are mostly in the aqueous solution. So first you get, you have to do the desolvation. Solvation means whatever you suppose you are having one material, one powder. If you solubilize it in water, then it is called solvation or hydration. Okay, so in case of it, if it is a hydrophilic, it is called hydration. Okay, when it is getting moist and it is getting dispersed over there and it is getting solubilized completely, and if the solvent is anything but your water, except the water, you can have the other organic solvents, then it is called solvation. Now, desolvation means the removal of this of the solvent. Okay, so once these droplets are formed, next we have the process of desolvation. Now, when you do the desolvation, you are left with aerosols. That means the dry powder is generated. Now, once these dry powders are generated, these dry powders, they are volatilized and subsequently atomized to get to convert into the free atoms. Okay, so any process of atomization, it would contain nebulization, desolvation, volatilization, and the generation of the free atoms. These four points should be there. Okay, if it is in the liquid state. Okay, however, in some cases, suppose you are having tablets in pharmaceuticals, we have the tablets, and you want to measure the API over there. I hope everyone knows what is API. It is active pharmaceutical ingredient, right? Now, if you have this API over here, then it is in the solid form. So, usually what happens, you may use a laser system to ablate this solid dosage forms. And that ablation, laser ablation, it generates the dry aerosol. Okay, so in solid system, you cannot have this nebulization, you cannot have this desolvation because it's already in the solid form. Okay, so by using the laser, we do laser ablation. Ablation means degeneration, and during that process, during this ablation process, the smaller particles, they are dislodged from the solid surfaces. Okay, and that ablated products, they result in the formation of the dry aerosols. Then you go for the volatilization, and then you go for the free generation of the free atoms. Okay, which we call atomization. The fourth step is atomization. Okay. Next, the purpose of the atomization step is to convert the analyte to a reproducible amount of gaseous atoms that appropriately represents the sample. Now, the process of sample atomization, it limits the accuracy, precision, and limit of detection of the analytical instruments, which includes all the three: atomic absorption spectroscopy, atomic fluorescence spectroscopy, and atomic emission spectroscopy. Okay. So, in all of this, if you see the sample atomization, it is playing an important role, and we have to give due consideration while we are trying to develop this. What you call, while we are trying to do some analysis, or even if you want to do some what you call analysis over there, you can do it. Okay. Now then, as I already told, for solid samples, we can go for laser ablation method. Okay. So this is how we achieve the atomization. Okay, we achieve the atomization. It is a continuous atomizer, both This one, the flame one, and the laser one. Okay. Now, when we talk about the flame atomizers, there are two types of atomizers. Okay. The first type, it is regarded as total consumption burner, and the second type, it is regarded as the premix burner. Now both of them, they have their own advantages and disadvantages. Okay, so let's talk about this thing. Now before going into the details of this one, I would like to give you how the continuous process is achieved. Because if you see, you have the sample introduction system. Okay, so how the sample is introduced? Okay, so you must have studied in your class 11-12 the Bernoulli's theorem. Okay, so over there, suppose you are having a channel like this, and then it is dipped into water, and you can do this experiment at home also. So, until unless you are not doing anything over here, you will not get any output. Okay, because at this point, a PV, say P1, V1 is equal to P2, V2. This P2, V2 is the air pressure just over here at this location, P2, V2. So there is no activity. Now, suppose if you try to start, or you start flowing some air, say through your mouth, then what will happen? Velocity over here will increase. If velocity increases, the pressure at this point will decrease. If V1 increases, then the P1, it will decrease. So what will happen? If it is decreasing, we have not done anything at this location, at this P2, V2 location. Okay. So now P2 is at a comparatively, P2 is comparatively higher as compared to P1. Now what it will do? It will start exerting pressure over here onto the liquid surface. And what, how it will be transformed? The liquid over here, it will start climbing this capillary, and it will come over here, and here we already have this air which is flowing. So what it will do? It will take this liquid and put it out over here, and it will be appearing over here as a mist, as a cloud. I hope everyone knows this funda, right? So, while we are doing this analysis, while we are doing this atomic optical spectrometry, this thing, it comes into picture because it is one of the simplest way for the nebulization process. Right? This is one of the simplest way for the nebulization process. Now, if you have to nebulize this, see, in inlet 1, you have the fuel. At inlet 2, you have the air or whatever you say, right? And here there is a capillary which is dipped into the solution. This is connected to the solution of your sample. Now, it provides you the perfect ये परफेक्ट कंडीशंस फॉर द प्रोसेस ऑफ द नेबुलाइजेशन. ओके, फॉर द प्रोसेस ऑफ द नेबुलाइजेशन. सो एज सून एज यू आर गेटिंग ओवर हियर, यू आर हैविंग द नेबुलाइज प्रोडक्ट्स. ओके, लेट मी चेंज द कलर. सो यू आर हैविंग द नेबुलाइज प्रोडक्ट ओवर हियर एंड यू हैव द फ्यूएल, यू हैव द एयर. सो फ्यूएल इज गेटिंग बर्न्ड, एयर इज गेटिंग गिविंग सफिशियंट ऑक्सीजन सप्लाई. सो दे आर गेटिंग दिस थिंग बर्न्ड. ओके, नाउ इफ यू सी ओवर हियर, व्हेन द फ्लेम्स आर बीइंग जनरेटेड, देयर आर थ्री रीजियंस और थ्री जोन्स. वन इज द प्राइमरी जोन, दिस इज द सेकेंडरी जोन एंड दिस इज योर इंटरनल जोन. सो वेन एवर वी हैव टू डू द एनालिसिस, वी हैव टू मेजर द ऑप्टिकल स्टफ इन द और द चेंजेस इन द ऑप्टिकल प्रॉपर्टी इन द इंटरनल जोन. ओके, द इंटरनल जोन इट इज हैविंग मोर रिड्यूसिंग एनवायरमेंट एज कंपेयर टू द सेकेंडरी जोन, बिकॉज द सेकेंडरी जोन इट इज इन कॉन्टैक्ट विथ एयर. ओके, सो देर इज एन एबंडेंट अमाउंट ऑफ एयर विच इज प्रेजेंट इन द अबंडेंट अमाउंट ऑफ एयर विच इज इन कॉन्टैक्ट विथ द सेकेंडरी जोन. सो इट इज गेटिंग मोर ऑफ व्हाट यू कॉल ऑक्सीजन फ्रॉम द एनवायरमेंट. And hence, the atoms which will be present over here in this secondary zone, it will be easily what you call them easily oxidized. And if it is getting oxidized, it is losing its property. Okay. So for the measurement of the atomic spectroscopic stuffs, you have to work in the internal zone. This is an important thing. Okay. Now, once it is there, once you have seen, now what is happening? If you see, when you are taking the samples and you are creating a mist, this is a physical process. Now, during the physical process, what will happen? Some droplets will be higher, bigger. Some droplets will be smaller. Okay. Now, one good thing, what is happening? Whatever the sample you are introducing, all the samples they are being consumed over here. So you will get a good signal to noise ratio. You will get a good signal to noise ratio. Okay? Because the number of atoms will be much higher and you will be getting the thing. However, if you see, as I said, there are some bigger droplets, there are some smaller droplets. Now, due to this uneven distribution of the droplet size, distribution of the droplet size, the flames which will be generated, it might not be stable. It might not be stable because the bigger droplets, they might not get the sufficient time to get desolvated, okay, or to undergo the complete process of this atomization. Okay, so that is one of the disadvantages of this total consumption burner, of this total consumption burner. Are you getting my point? Anyone who is having any problem up till now, please ask me, because then I will go to this next one.
No, sir, no problems as
No?
such.
Okay, good. So we have seen that there is a problem with the flame. the flame is not that much stable in total consumption burner. Okay, now what? So to avoid this premix burner, it has come into existence. Let me draw a simple diagram of this one. This is sample air or N2O nitrous oxide, and this is a fuel. Okay. So the sample introduction process is same. So if you see, we have got a fuel oxidant. Okay, then you have in some adjusting flow rate, this thing, then you have this sample capillary through which the sample comes. Then over here you have the nebulizer and all these things. Okay, so we are taking into consideration the sample through this Bernoulli's theorem. It is already getting nebulized, okay, because of the flowing of the air and the fuel. And there is another port over here, extra port. If you see, this is called drain. Okay, so what happens as soon as you are getting over here, okay, and over here you have another extra air. So it is something like that. You have a concentric tube like stuff. Okay. So this sample introduction, it is being done in this way. Okay, so here, from here the mist is being generated, and these are being generated over here, and from here you are having the air. And yeah, for the atomization process we use the air here. Okay, so these are being automatically atomized over here. Now if you see, we have certain structures over here which are regarded as flow spoiler. Okay, which are regarded as flow spoiler. What is flow spoiler? These are nothing but baffles. In biochemical engineering you must have heard of baffles, right? Now what happens in the baffles? So you as we discussed previously, we have some larger droplets, we have some finer mists. Okay, the mist has also formed over here. Now while going through these baffles, the heavier droplet, they are not good enough to pass this baffle. Okay, so you can look into this way. A football match is going on. Okay, a football match is going on, and you have some opponents over here. Okay, and in the opponent you have another team. Now if one of the opponent is quite bulky, he will not be able to pass freely from here. However, a thinner guy who is much more flexible and energetic, he will be able to pass through this and score a goal, right? So the same thing happens over here. Here these red marks, they are the player of the red team, and they act as the baffle or the barriers. Okay, now these players or these baffles, they act as a stopper for the larger droplets. Only the finer mists, which are able to go through the baffles, they come at this region. They come at this region and then they generate the flame. This is a flame. So here we have the burner and all this thing. Right? So in this case, depending upon how you are creating this thing and how are your sample, as much as 90 to 95% of your sample, liquid sample, it may be wasted. Okay, it may be wasted. Only the finer mist, they will gain entry into the burner. And this is, see, this is how the burner head looks like. Now, if you see, there is a very long line like thing, so it will generate a flame which is something like this. Now why it is done? In the first case, our all of the sample, they were going inside the flame and they were being burned, so the density of the atoms per unit of area in this area, it was quite high, and due to that reason we got higher signal to noise ratio. Okay, however, in this case, if you see, around 90 to 95% of the atoms, whatever, or the of the samples, whatever you are introducing in the system, they are getting wasted. You are at the flame, you are just getting 5 to 10% of the samples, it is entering into the flame, which you can analyze. So what is the way around? In our UV spectrophotometry class, we have discussed that if the concentration is very low, then we increase the path length. Okay, and it was also true in the case of the fluorescence. We have seen that longer cuvettes were used, could be used in the fluorescence spectroscopy, right? This is the same thing over here. Now over here, what you do, you are getting a longer flame. Now while analyzing this thing, here you are using a point radiation. Sorry, it is not visible. Yeah, so you can get a point radiation which will pass through this internal flame, and you can analyze the whatever is the output using a detector, that same line. But in this case, let me again draw it. But in this case, instead of using a single point, it is always better to go for a radiation which is having certain length and width. So what you are doing over here, you are increasing the chances of inclusion of larger amount of radiation or the larger amount of the atoms during the analysis. And in this way, you are trying to increase the signal to noise ratio. Basically, what you are doing, you are increasing the path length. By increasing the path length, you are increasing the SNR. Inherently, this premix burner, it should have a low SNR. However, by increasing the path length for the analysis, you are compensating the signal component, so as to you are compensating the loss of the atoms to increase the signal to noise ratio. Okay, I hope you have understood what I have been trying to tell you, right? So this is one of the advantages of this one is that the larger droplets, they do not get to this burner head, okay, get to this burner head. Now due to this reason, the flame which is being generated, it is more stable flame. So the chances of noise component would be lesser. In other words, the accuracy of measurement of the atomic transitions, it would increase. Am I clear? Anyone who wants to ask anything? No? Okay. Now, we are having different types of oxidants. Oxygen is there, air is there, nitrous oxide is there. Then you have natural gas, hydrogen, acetylene, natural gas, hydrogen, acetylene, acetylene. So you see the oxygen at this thing. You can use this. What is this? You can use this liquid petroleum gas also. Okay. And from there you use it. So can you now, are you getting the confidence that you can make an at least atomic emission spectroscopy, spectroscopy in your lab? I feel I have given you sufficient literature so that you can develop your own atomic emission spectroscopy. Yeah, I don't expect that you will be getting a very good result, but at least you can develop something and then try to build up on that. And this is what research is. Okay. So what I want is that you people try to understand what is the instrumentation behind a specific instrument. You learn what is the mechanics or the mechanism of the functioning of the instrument and try to think. Okay. If you try to think, there is nothing which is impossible. See, in today's world, you can get a lot of free literature and you can definitely be able to develop many of the equipments, at least for schools and colleges. Okay, you may not be getting very good results from here. So you may be interested in supplying whatever the equipment you make, if you do make, to schools and colleges, at least the students will understand the basic principle. I don't know whether you know or don't know, in Western countries, they give the exposure to the kids to these equipments at a very young age. Okay. But in countries like India, we do not have that much liberty of having larger equipments. But at least if you can make this affordable for schools so that the kids can do something, it will help you guys in shaping our country in a better way. Okay. So anyway, I'm getting off the grid. So yeah, so maximum burning velocity and all these things, these are there. Now the next time type of the stuff is electrochemical, electrothermal atomizer. So this is a graphite tube which is usually used. So if you see, there is a hole over here, and it is usually the sample, it is used for the sample inlet. Now this is a cartridge like thing. Now this graphite, it is being put into the this electrothermal atomizer. Okay, now over here if you see gas in, okay, so in the gas in, what happens is that there should have been, yeah, so maybe they are flushing it out from here. Okay, so gas is coming in. And then this gas, it is basically argon gas, which is used. And over here, I'm marking it in the red. Okay. There is a small platform, which they have not shown over here. There is a small platform over here within the graphite tube, over where we can introduce samples. I am putting drawing the samples in blue color. Okay, so you can put the samples, and then this graphite tube, it is being electrically heated. Okay, now you have a removable window. Why this removable window is needed? Because while putting the sample, you have to use micro syringe. Micro syringe to put in the sample over here, and usually it is 25 what you call microliter or to say a few mg's or milliliters. Microliters, so yeah, it is, yeah, it is mostly in microliters, and maybe in high microliters and near to the milliliters. Say some near to 1 ml. Okay, but lower the better. Okay, so you remove the window, put in the sample using this thing, so it puts gets into the platform. Then you have a metal jacket. In the metal jacket, you have the water in, water out, and this is used for as a chilling agent, so that the temperature of this assembly, it does not get too high. Okay. Now, how the atomization is achieved? So this is the platform. Over there, there will be the sample. So first there will be a heating this thing, which is usually done at around 150 degrees centigrade. Okay. So under this, what you do, you go for this thing, evaporation of the solvent. So what is that? Desolvation. And at this temperature, this graphite tube, it is maintained for at this temperature for say 30 to 40 seconds. Okay. Second step, it is again heat. So what happens? This heating is around 600 to 700 degrees centigrade. What happens over here? Volatile 700 degrees C, volatilization of organic compounds. Okay, so this the first one is for 30 to 40 seconds, then the second one is also for 30 to 40 seconds. Okay. And then after that, third step is again heating at 2300 to 2700 C. And this process, this step, it is for the volatilization come atomization. Okay, and during this step, the light is passed through this channel. There is an opening, if you see, through this the light is being passed and that is being analyzed. So you have a detector over here, the sample is being analyzed, and usually you have quartz window over here, and somewhere here also for the escape of the gas, you have the gas out. So why this is needed? Initially, when you have added the sample, during that process you will be having airs. So first the air is being eliminated from the whole system. So you are analyzing the samples in a what you call in a oxygen free area, right? Then second is during this atomization, all the atoms are being employed, or all the atoms are being used, all the atoms within the samples, they are being used for the analysis. Okay, and also during the volatilization and of the organic compounds, and also the desolvation process, this gas purging using the argon, it helps you in removing the solvent vapors and the organic compounds from the system before the samples are analyzed, which is not possible in the flame atomizers. Okay, so we may have some interferences from the organic compounds. Okay, so that remains the thing, and this is one of the advantage of this system. And again, since we are using all the atoms, the signal to noise ratio is quite high. The only disadvantage of this system is that after each step you have to change this graphite tubes and do the analysis. Okay, that is one of the major disadvantage of this electrothermal atomizer. Okay, and then after this thing, you have to clean this atomizer, this graphite tube. How the cleaning is done? Post the analysis, the cleaning is done by heating this graphite tube at around 3000 degrees centigrade for 10 to 15 minutes, so that all the residual samples, they are evaporated. Okay, now points to consider over here: flame atomic atomization is the most reproducible of all the liquid sample. Okay, flame atomization has a lower sensitivity than electrothermal atomization. Now you know why this is so, because in electrothermal atomization all the samples are analyzed, all the atoms are being analyzed. Which is not possible in the flame atomization. Okay. Then samples could be drained as waste and therefore have a low residence time, leading to low efficiency. This is for the flame atomization. Okay. And flame fluctuations can affect the absorbance of the samples. When we talk about these premix burners, even there might be some flame fluctuations. This is because maybe some of the bulky particles, they may gain entry into the flame depending upon the viscosity of the solvent which you have used. Okay, so in those cases, if the viscosity is low, they may, the larger droplets, they may gain entry into the flame, and that is one of the important thing. Okay, now next is we talked about ICP AES, which is inductively coupled plasma. Okay, now here then, if you see, we have this aqueous dissolved sample, you have the nebulizer, we have seen, and the nebulization over here, it is achieved using the argon. Okay, instead of air, it is performed in argon. Okay, now once that is done, it is nebulized over here. See, you are having in the droplet these things, and then you are having some droplets are being drained out, the larger droplets. Only a selected few it gains entry at this location where you are having the argon over here also. And just at this tip, we have a RF power supply. We have a coil over here, and we provide a high intensity RF, radio frequency signal. Now, this radio frequency signals, what it does, it converts argon to argon ions and electrons. And this mixture, it is called plasma. It is having a very high temperature, and this results in the this other process, the volatilization and the atomization. And then the tip of this one, it is used on this flame, it is used for the analysis. And if you are measuring the intensity of the light at this tip at a 90 degree from this flame, then it is called radial positioning of the detector. Okay, and then it can also be the detector can also be placed at axial positioning of the axial positioning, which is at the straight line in the direction of the flame. Okay, so you can put the detectors either in the radial position or in the axial position. Okay, now I talked about ablation, laser ablation. The laser ablation is done using the neodymium doped yttrium aluminum garnet. We call it ND-YAG laser in short. Okay, so this laser is used for the ablation process. Okay, now it has nothing to do, because I have taken both of these from different sources, so the nebulization process has been shown differently. But over here also you can use this normal nebulization process. Okay, so instead of the laser ablation, you can have this normal nebulization process. Okay, so this is just a schematic representation of this one. So both of them are a type of ICP AES. Okay, so if you have anything, I'll be happy to ask, I'll be happy to answer. So with this, we'll complete this chapter basically. Hello. Are you guys there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I think Sayed was having problem in the last class regarding the atomization process.
No, sir. No, sir.
No?
That was cleared, like in this class, it was pretty clear.
Okay. Anyone else? No? Okay then.